Breaking news, ladies. The Fertility Awareness Mastery Mentorship Program, Class of 2022, starts in January. If you are a women's health professional with an existing practice and you've struggled to incorporate fertility awareness charting into your client work, this is the program you've been waiting for. There's nothing like it offered anywhere. Transform your practice in 9 months. We start the first week of January. Apply now at fertilityfriday.com/FAMMLive. That's fertilityfriday.com/FAMMLIVE. This is the Fertility Friday Podcast, episode number 396. Welcome to the Fertility Friday Podcast, your source for information about the fertility awareness method and all things fertility. I'm your host, Lisa Hendrickson-Jack. I'm the author of The Fifth Vital Sign and the Fertility Awareness Mastery Charting Journal. I'm a certified fertility awareness educator and holistic reproductive health practitioner with nearly 20 years of experience teaching women to connect to their fifth vital sign through menstrual cycle charting, balancing hormonal health, and optimizing the menstrual cycle without hormones. I'm outspoken about hormonal birth control and its impact on fertility and overall health because you have the right to know how your body works and how artificial hormones disrupt that natural process. I host live coaching programs to help you achieve optimal fertility and health because it's important to have healthy menstrual cycles regardless of whether or not you want to have babies. I'm also a wife and mother of two beautiful boys. I know, I'm a busy girl, but I managed to fit it all in. This podcast is designed to empower you to take full control of your cycles, your fertility, and your overall health. And I'm so excited that you're here with us today. In today's newest episode in the FAMM Practitioner series, I'm sharing an interview with Dani Sheriff. Today's episode is a little bit different from the previous episodes in the series because when Dani started the program, she was actually pregnant at the start of the program. And she had her beautiful baby in the middle of the program. Well, maybe not the middle, maybe towards the latter part of it. And so in today's episode, Dani's actually sharing her birth story. And what's unique about her birth story is that, I mean, if you're listening in real time, then you'll know that, you know, she delivered in pandemic times. And so she's sharing her experience, what that was like in the face of various challenges, restrictions, and different things. In addition to her personal experience and story with birth, she does share some of her takeaways and insights that she received in the program and how it has impacted her work with clients. So before we jump in, let me tell you a little bit about Dani. Dani Sheriff is an Australian-born, Austin-based podcaster, YouTuber, and digital illustrator. She's the host of the Hypothalamic Amenorrhea Podcast and the founder of the HA Society, a podcast and online community for women who care about getting their periods. Her mission is to free up mental space for people who are caught up in the diet hard mindset so they can do their life's greatest work. So without further ado, let's jump into today's episode with Dani. And I'm excited to be here once again with Dani Sheriff. For those of you who have tuned into the podcast, I interviewed Dani a little while ago, maybe a year ago. So I'll link the previous episode.
Probably not that long ago.
I feel like it wasn't that. Yeah.
No, I was pregnant at the time. So not that long.
Maybe not even. Well, by the time it comes out, maybe about a year ago, but I don't know. Maybe yeah. Not even. But this time it's kind of a different interview. So when I had interviewed you, we had kind of just met. And I think I don't remember if I was on your podcast and you were on mine.
Yeah,
and
came on.
But now it's a totally different thing because you are nearly a graduated member of the Fertility Awareness Mastery Mentorship Program. Yes. And so at the time that we're recording this interview, I'd have to count the months. I think we're 6 months in now because we're basically at the end of our official time. And I feel like a lot has happened since then. So welcome to the show, Dani.
Thank you. Excited to be here and talk about charting and in practice. And yeah, I love it.
Yeah. Awesome. I feel like our last episode, because the work you do is pretty niche, you work with specifically women with HA, which is hugely important since women with HA are often kind of falling through the cracks, misdiagnosed. Like we could get into all of that, but that was kind of the focus, I think, of our previous episode. It was really informative about HA in general and how it shows up in the cycle and how charting can be extremely useful throughout that process. But what I wanted to ask you a little bit about is if we could start, if you wanted to share your experience with charting, if you want to just touch on your own experience with HA, but I'd love to hear about your experience of charting. And as you mentioned, you just had a baby. And I feel like that's a really positive, helpful, and empowering story for women who are struggling right now with HA and kind of wondering what it can look like on the other end of getting your period back.
Yeah. Oh, cool. So I, like most people who don't have a period, didn't chart while I didn't have one, which is kind of funny because I'm a huge advocate for charting when you don't have one, or at least using some of the tools from charting while you don't have one. But it was just because I didn't know that you could or have any of the context or information. So I went through a recovery story, which we've talked about on your show before. When I did, I always knew when I get my period back, I'm going to use FAMM. So around like right at my first cycle, I started doing it. And through that process and all the troubleshooting, and there's just such a huge learning curve, I started realizing like, oh, this would still be something helpful for temperatures, right? Basal body temperatures. This would be something that's helpful for people with HA to look into. And I was like, it's kind of an indicator of like how kind of deep into this you might be. I thought that was really interesting. And then I thought it was really interesting that you could use mucus as a sign. And at that point, before I got my first period back after years of not having one, I did know about the mucus because I'd been hearing some things while I dove into the world of just period health. And that was really helpful because I knew what it was and I knew why I was having it. And so my introduction was kind of like little bits and bobs here. And then when I got my period, I was able to learn how to chart and see in hindsight, this can really help people who don't have a period yet. And there's a story happening or a message happening that you need your period before you can learn about these things. And I started a podcast and got really passionate about HA recovery and started to work this information in where other people weren't. And I love like seeing the community is clearly more educated on it now. And I think that's very cool. So I use that and, you know, through the process of using FAMM, was able to see that my cycle wasn't optimized just because I got it back. And like, that was a huge deal. And as no one's talking about this. So that's something that I brought into my message as well. It doesn't end there. It just begins there. Yeah. And I'm like still learning all the time and joined your mentorship as someone who's a coach in this exact thing, exactly what I needed. And yeah, I'm just like constantly trying to learn more so I can apply it to myself and these people. And obviously it helped me get pregnant. My cycle wasn't optimized, used all the information, used the chart, solved the issues, got pregnant. Like that's how it works.
Well, I love what you said there because it's so important. I think for anyone who is in that kind of cycle charting world, then it makes logical sense that if you haven't had a period for an extended period of time, whether that's 6 months or a year or more, that logically, when you first get it back, from my perspective anyways, that there's going to be a bit of a transition. You know, your body's it's kind of like the car was sitting in the garage for however long and we just started it. So it might need a little bit of oil change, like not the best example, but I think everyone can kind of resonate with that. And I mean, in your case, when you said that your cycle wasn't optimized, I feel like what we had talked about in the program was that there was a period of time, correct me if I'm wrong, where the luteal wasn't like as long as it needed to be and you had some symptoms there and you worked to...
And ovulation and short luteal phases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, I think that it's what you said about just even... Well, I actually want you to expand on that a little bit because what you said was that you didn't chart your cycles at all when you weren't having a period. And on the one hand, it kind of makes sense because charting can be really frustrating when you're not having a period because then you're just having long extended phases of typically not a whole lot going on, you know, especially if you have kind of unaddressed HA, you might not even have any mucus. So it might just be like dry all the time and nothing's going on and the temperature is kind of not really doing a whole lot. But at the same time, you also mentioned that it can be helpful. So from your experience now on the other side of it, how could charting be helpful for someone who is in those stages, who is yet not yet ovulating, menstruating?
I love this question because when we're going down the track of trying to get our period back, there's it feels like there's one of two things. I have a period or I don't have a period and there's no in between. But the thing is, like, it doesn't always necessarily just, your period doesn't just turn back on like immediately. There are signs of progress along the way. And that helps with the frustration sometimes. I mean, sure, if you're seeing absolutely nothing, it's kind of a sign that progress is really slow. But I get to use it with people by being like, yeah, but look, you know, your temperatures were 36, 35 degrees. And now after a month, you're up into the normal pre-ovulatory ranges. Like, that's huge progress. That's showing us that you're on the way. Things are working, because people just feel like nothing's working. It's not working. I'm eating all the food. I'm in a calorie surplus, which I need for recovery, but nothing's working. But, oh, are you starting to see cervical mucus? Because now you know what you're looking for. Are you seeing an improvement in your temperatures? Because now you're looking for it. And those, or like, are you seeing them stabilize? Are they all over the place, but now they're looking a little bit better? So for that reason, it's been really good to help us see when we thought we were blind, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I just had a thought of the person who like literally just like randomly turned into this episode and doesn't know a lot about HA. Could you just give us the, like, I always have to do that because you can't assume that everyone knows exactly what it is. So give us the kind of elevator, short and sweet. What is HA? Why does it result in the loss of a period? You know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Everyone listen to this and then go back and start again, so you have the context. So amenorrhea is the absence of a cycle, right? And there's primary and the secondary amenorrhea. Primary, you've never had a period before. You always hear about that in like child athletes and stuff, or, you know, people who had an eating disorder from a really young age. And then the secondary, where you've had a period before and then it went away. So you're of menstruating age, you should be cycling, but you're not. And hypothalamic amenorrhea is the absence of period, basically due to energy deficiency. So under eating, over exercising, chronic stress, and we usually like to define it as, or diagnose it with one of, at least two of the three is usually what we see. Mostly we see women who are over exercising and under eating, especially in this day and age, as everyone knows that person, right? It's so common. And although not everyone loses their period when they're in a stressed state like that, many of us do. And there's women who have like a high tolerance and a lower tolerance, and you don't have to be underweight, and you don't have to think that you don't have to realize that you're doing it in order for it to be happening. So energy deficit, and most people solve it by increasing their energy intake, either by eating more food, by resting more, and most commonly by doing a combination of both.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that. And I mean, the reason that I wanted to ask you that, just to make sure everyone's kind of like on the same page here, mm-hmm. is because you had mentioned the temperature. So, you know, one of the fertile signs that we monitor with fertility awareness cycle charting is the basal body temperature, which is vital sign. It's one of the main accepted four vital signs, your body temperature. And so if you have that situation where you have chronic, essentially under energy, whether it's that you're like the combination of under eating or over exercising and et cetera, the temperature is a great way to see visually what's happening. When you don't eat, essentially when you're in a state of starvation, whether you're aware of it or not, your body temperature typically decreases because our bodies are smarter than we are. So if you're not giving yourself enough energy, then that's one of the ways that your body conserves energy so that you kind of are able to sustain with the limited energy that you're providing it. So I thought that was a really great example of, you know, even if you're not cycling yet, to have that. But I feel like especially with HA, that would be so helpful for you to kind of gauge where your clients are at, and then also be able to see that they're improving as they address the energy deficiency.
Mm-hmm. It's really helpful to see where people are at. And when you first do their intake and you get them to start taking their temperature, you get a really good picture painted of this might take longer than they're hoping, or this person's like, their vitals are looking pretty good. I think that we're really just around the corner from at least seeing, you know, our first signs of mucus or actually getting our first period. So yeah, it's really, really helpful tool.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the mucus piece of it as well, because if you are basically the classic chart way to identify HA on the chart. So I think we spoke about this briefly as well, like the difference, because people kind of like, what's the difference between HA and PCOS? Like, how do I know and whatever? And so we won't get into all of that, but very basically, you know, women with HA typically on the chart, they're not showing mucus because they're under eating. They have this energy deficit situation happening. And so their body's just kind of not doing anything. Like, we're not really making the hormones. Like, that's why you're not having a period, because the hormones are basically not being produced. Yeah. Right. So, so that's one of the big differences as well, how you can kind of identify it with charting. In your case, so you did manage to get your period back, obviously, and that was the kind of the beginning. And then over time, you were able to improve your cycle parameters and kind of improve that luteal phase and get to a more regular ovulatory spot that allowed you to conceive. And you recently had your baby like a month ago.
6 weeks. Yeah.
And you're here.
Seven. Yeah. I was back in class like that week.
I was amazed. I think everyone else was also amazed. But you had mentioned that you, just to share a little bit about your story, because you mentioned that you had, I suppose, not a challenging birth. For anyone who's listening to this in the future, I mean, we're recording this in 2021. It's like the epic 2-year period of, I don't even know what to say, but continual upheaval, maybe. I feel like that's an appropriate way to talk about it. So maybe share a little bit about your experience. And I feel like you had said something to me when you did conceive, because you had not had a period for so long. So it was very meaningful, kind of, even just to get to that point.
Yeah. Yes. So I like the term continuous upheaval. That's a good, like, every single person has made a plan that hasn't been able to go ahead.
It's constantly changing.
Yeah. And I like identify as someone who is always very normal and like healthy. Yes, I had HA, but I sort of argue that HA is a healthy mechanism. It's meant to be there. It's serving a purpose. Your body's functioning when it lets it happen. So I identify as a person who like, weird things don't happen to, like, I don't go to hospital. So I was expecting a really normal birth. Everything was going to go to plan. I was going to go to a birth center. So it's not attached to a hospital. It's just midwives, because everything's going to go smoothly. And then the whole pregnancy went accordingly. All my levels were good. Everything came back, you know, all tests came back really well. And I was like, on top of the world, this is going exactly how I knew it would go. And then I reached my due date, went overdue. I expect that because first time mom, and that's common. But then at 40 weeks and 4 days, I was like, I can't smell or taste anything. And I'm not feeling well. Like, I just don't feel good. And I have this, I'm starting to get a cough and the whole thing. And then I just realized, oh dear. So discovered I was positive with the disease, and the whole thing went out the window. And I was just like, I don't even know how to deal with such adversity. Like, this is not what happens to me. But it did. And so I wasn't able to go to the birth center, and they didn't even want to induce me, which everyone thought would happen, because I was so sick at that point. I could only breathe in to like 70% lung capacity. And they're like, we're actually going to wait and hope that you get better by the time you have this baby. So I needed, just based on like the CDC guidelines, if I could make it to exactly a week later, I would be able to go to the birth center and have the birth that I wanted. And I was like, I'm 40 weeks and 4 days. Like, how am I going to make it a whole extra week? And so that was a really fun week of just like trying to survive, feeling so sick, worrying that how am I going to get through labor if I can't breathe, and try coughing, but trying not to cough. Like, it's so bad. And it hurts your stomach when you have a cough, when you're that pregnant, that you're like moaning just to get, instead of coughing, to try and get it to pass. And then the morning, the day before, so I was trying to get to Wednesday, but Tuesday morning at 5:45 AM, I was like, these are contractions. So off we went to the hospital, and my husband had to drop me off at the ER and just like wave goodbye. And I'm like walking in myself. I've got my suitcase. I'm like moaning. They don't know what to do with me, because for whatever reason, they're unorganized enough to like, everyone was given a heads up I was coming, but I walk in and I'm, you know, I have to say, I'm here, labor and delivery's expecting me, I'm COVID positive, like do what you got to do. And everyone's in shock. Like, I can't believe she walked in here with the Rona. Like no one knows what to do. I'm by myself. I'm having contractions in the ER. And I have to fill out all the paperwork that like normally your partner would do. It was really tough just to be alone. And then they just kind of wheel you up and put you in a room and leave you there.
Oh, no.
It's like, I don't know what I'm doing. My doula can't come. And so I just like, I don't know, went into survival mode to get through this. And I was like, we're doing the epidural, because you can't have an epidural at a birth center, at least not at my birth center. So it's all natural births. And that was a part of my plan, but I was feeling those contractions. I was having back labor, which is especially painful. And I was like, yeah, because there's no one's going to help me change positions. No one's going to be doing counter pressure on my back. Like, I need that. So we did that. Eventually a friend was actually able to come, which was awesome, because my husband couldn't come because he had COVID as well. So he wasn't allowed to come, but she came, and that was helpful to have someone, but she didn't know all of my preferences and what I wanted. And so it was hard for her to really advocate for me very much, but at least I had her like look into her eyes. Mm-hmm. And so we got to the pushing phase about 3 hours after I had been there, and they came in. It had been 2 hours that I had been pushing. And because I couldn't breathe, I could only push for like maybe anywhere between 6 and 8 seconds, which is probably pretty good considering, but I still had to wear a mask even though I couldn't breathe. So I would like push and then move my head to the side and lift up the mask to try and catch my breath. And so 2 hours in, they come in having had taken an X-ray of my chest when I first got there to tell me I have pneumonia as well. So I didn't realize, but they're like, you have pneumonia. And I don't know what that means. Like, I don't get sick. What do you mean I have pneumonia? So they antibiotics or something, I don't even know. Like, they just like, don't worry about it. We're just telling you have it. We can't believe they're telling me this now. It's like, it's just not helpful. And I had to push for another hour before she came out. And at this point, like, you're getting really tired. Even if you're not really sick, you're getting pretty tired. And lots of nurses had started to come in, and they wanted to recommend a vacuum for me, which I'd never really like even looked into, because as far as I was concerned, I was not even going to need to touch that option with a 10-foot pole ever. So I didn't really even know what it was. And I really wanted this done because I was worried that I would get to a point where I had to have a C-section because I can't breathe anymore and I can't push and my endurance is gone. So I was like, all right, well, let's do the vacuum. And they needed to like give me a spiel, like 15 minutes about how the vacuum works and all the risks and stuff. And as you would also know, Lisa, you don't care what people, like, you don't want to hear people talking to you.
No, you can't really interpret. That's why you need your partner there.
Yeah. I was staring at her going, like, just nodding my head But in my head, I was like, shut up and get this baby out of me now. Because her head was like showing. She was there, but she'd been there for like an hour. Mm. So after the spiel, I think it was just that I had had a nice rest, like a 15-minute rest, because I hadn't had that throughout the whole process. Mm. And I thought that they were doing the vacuum. I was like, we're going, they're going, like, just, you can do this. Just two big pushes, give it everything you have, and the vacuum will do the rest. So we did that, and the baby came out, and they told me right when that happened that I didn't even use the vacuum, that I did it myself, which I was very proud. Like, if there was like one huge positive takeaway for me, it was that I can't believe I did that with everything that was going on inside of my body and without my husband there, who was being FaceTimed in. And then it's so interesting. No one tells you this. And I think that this is kind of like a cool tip, but when you're preparing for birth, everyone's telling you, you know your rights and know like what you, if you don't want them to do something, just say, I don't consent, and know your plan and everything that you want. And all of that goes out the window. Like, you could know everything that you want, and then you're there and you're so relieved that that baby's out, that you're not doing that anymore. And there's all kinds of hormones that are making you feel good, that it's kind of like being drunk at a party and you're just like down for what it, like, yeah, totally fine. You do that. Oh, okay. I don't mind. It's okay if you do that, but that's temporary. And I didn't know I would really be in that state. So they took her from me and they bathed her, which is not common practice now, right? Like, to people don't.
Yeah, they leave the, because there's vernix on the skin, and arguably it's very good for the skin, and it's nice to have it on for a while because it keeps the skin moisturized and all these things.
And that was important to me. But because I was a COVID patient, it was apparently protocol. And so I gave in really easily. They were like, we have to bath her. This is now protocol. And I was immediately like sad, but I felt like they're the authority and I have to do what they say. Like, I was weak and I was in this, literally in this like vulnerable, incapacitated position. And these people who are wearing hazmat suits all around me are just like doing all this stuff, and they're suturing me. And she's just like, I have to take your baby. And I was like, oh, okay. And there's lots of little things like that that happened. And it's like, because I didn't have my support person there and I couldn't do it for myself, because even though I was present and conscious, I wasn't myself.
No, because you just had a child. You're in one of the most vulnerable situations possible, because also it's not just about you. It's about the baby and what's best for the baby. And you have to make this decision right now, and you need to make that decision immediately. And, or I don't even tell you that you get to choose anything. I'm going to tell you that this is how it's going to go, even though you could potentially advocate for you. Yeah. So, well, I have a question for you, Dani, because I feel like I've gotten to know you a bit over the 6 months that you were in the practitioner training program, and I kind of knew you a little bit before. And I wouldn't characterize you as like an overly emotional person, generally speaking. Like, you're pretty kind of to the point, like straight-laced kind of person. That's been my impression of you. Yeah. But I just want to know how this impacted you, because I mean, I think that you did amazing. I think, honestly, it's kind of what you do, right? Because you go into the mama bear survival instinct kind of thing.
You have no other choice.
Yeah. You didn't. And I think you did amazing. I think everyone who's listening is like, what would I have done in that situation? Right. But how did you feel? You know, like, it's been 6 weeks. I know that when I had a different birth experience, but I feel like you kind of are in shock for the first little while and everything's different. You've got a baby now. And so it kind of takes time to really process, but like, how did you feel emotionally?
And it did take time to process, because I also had to stay in the hospital with just the baby by myself for 3 days. So
your husband didn't get to meet the baby right away.
He, funnily enough, our, like, remember I said that we were, we would have been outside of the realm the next day. So I had her at 6 p.m. and he was allowed to come in at midnight. So I know the nurses were also kind of like, they felt bad that they, you know, had to enforce this rule. So
he was allowed very arbitrary.
It felt, yeah. And it's always changing. So he was allowed to come in, but because we have a dog at home and we don't want anyone to have to go and, like, we were trying to be people pleasers. And I think we really should have just asked friends to go and feed our dog.
Obviously. We just didn't want to
ask. I know. I was like, didn't want to ask people to go into our house. Like, what if they got sick or what if they were uncomfortable and felt like they had to? So he ended up having to go home at 8 a.m. the next day in order to care for our dog. And because he was visiting me, he wasn't allowed to return. Even though we were past the, like, the 10 days post first symptoms, he wasn't allowed to come back. So after that, he had met her, but I was by myself for the rest of it. And that was like, I didn't have time to process because I was busy dealing with my vagina and trying, like, coughing with that, like, whole, literally getting my hands and holding myself in and trying to understand breastfeeding and dealing with the pain of that and getting, you know, all the extra care for the pneumonia and everything, having to get up to feed her when I couldn't, and, like, doing it by myself and not being allowed to have access to the nursery. So I had to have her with me at all times. The whole thing was just so busy, no sleep, because they come in every hour to check on either you or her and they, like, flick the lights on and, like, whatever. So then I got home finally and I was just in such relief to be home that I was in this elated mood. And so it was like, as the days went on, I started to think about it more and process it more and be like, really wish they didn't bath her. Like, really wish that they didn't, you know, rush me into this, or that they let me get some sleep. Like, what was the point of being there to get better if I can't sleep? Like, sleep would probably have fixed a vast majority of the issues they were trying to fix. And, like, that analytical, like, professor brain going through every little thing that I didn't like. And there's a piece of everyone's birth experience that's not going to plan. Like, whatever. So I was prepared to accept that some things will happen and let them slide. But yeah, as time goes on, I kind of mourn the experience I didn't get to have. And, like, Jake didn't get to come to my first ultrasounds because of this whole thing. Now he didn't get to come. Like, both of us didn't have the experience that I think we kind of dreamt of having. And yeah, emotionally, I mourn that. But it's not, I'm not losing sleep. I'm just angry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so powerful. I just want to thank you, of course, for sharing your story so openly and honestly. I mean, it's, and I can't imagine how many women have gone through similar.
There were other women in there. Like, we had our own little area of the ward.
Yeah, I bet. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, a close friend of mine had a baby during this time, and similar, like, yeah, her experience was different, but similar in that she wasn't able to, like, she didn't really get to see anybody, and she had additional complications. So she had to be in the hospital for a longer period of time. And so she was basically in there by herself for a really long time.
I bet.
It's like the worst time to be by yourself. The worst time when you're bringing a baby into the world, especially as a first time mom. So my heart goes out to you. I'm glad that you made it through that. You know what I mean? Like, there's, of all the negative things that happened, like, I'm happy that you are ultimately healthy once you recover from the double pneumonia situation. That baby was healthy, but yeah, I can't imagine. And I think for most women who birth in the hospitals, it depends on the situation and all that. But I think a lot of women find that there are different decisions and choices. Maybe they feel pressure about certain things. And yeah, I think you're right to say that, you know, most of us don't necessarily get the, like, birth of our dreams.
Yeah, very, very few people. So it's on my list when people are like, do you want another baby? I'm like, oh, I kind of want like a redemption birth. But then what if that just won't go to plan either. So it's fine.
Well, I mean, it's either positive or negative, but as the time passes, because it's still very soon, you know.
Well, it's always going to be a good story. Like, I'm going to get asked again, like, what's the hardest thing you've ever done? And I have the answer now.
Yeah. Birthed alone in a hospital during
COVID war. Pneumonia. Sounds ridiculous. Like, it doesn't sound like it happened to me, you know.
Well, and when you were talking about it, I mean, it's hard enough to breathe. And when you were saying like, you had to kind of like try to sneak some breaths, you know, out from under. It's just,
yeah.
But yeah, so what I meant by that was that like 6 months from now, a year from now, you're always going to remember it. It's like going to be seared in your mind. But I feel like Mother Nature kind of like softens it a little.
Something. Yeah.
Like I remember like the week after I gave birth and I could still feel the pain in my vagina. I was like, this is never happening again. Nope. So that was good. I'm good.
I remember the very first strong contraction. I was like, oh yeah, no. Not which happens to everyone, I think.
Well, I mean, for me, I don't know if I've ever told my full birth story on the podcast, which I won't do now, but what I'll say is that because I had really painful periods for the majority of my, you know, early 20s, when I actually went into labor, I didn't think it was labor. I was like, these must be Braxton Hicks. This can't be a contraction. Because I didn't have back labor though.
Such bad pain.
Yeah. So, but A, yeah, I was used to having these horrific periods. B, I did not have back labor. Back labor is a completely different conversation. When the baby's sunny side up and it's back to back, that's like a whole other level. So I did not experience that. But literally, like all day, I was like, ah. until I was like, maybe they're not Braxton Hicks.
Well, everyone says like it feels like menstrual cramps. That it's hard to imagine that. It does, but I kind of get it because I don't get period cramps, but I do get like the dull backache. And so I was like, oh, is this just how it manifests for me? Because she wasn't sunny side up. She was like, she was, I guess, sideways. So enough. But the nurses were saying she's having back labor, which I don't even know how they know that.
Based on the woman.
Like just how she's reacting.
Yeah. It's very like, I'm not an expert in this field. I mean, I've got friends that are like labor and delivery nurses and I've, you know, spoken to a lot of, but back labor is a different beast because it's a much, much harder to manage the pain yourself. Mm. I think that's how they would know, literally by the amount of pain the woman's in.
Interesting.
Yeah. I'm curious. I wish we were in our group now because we've got a couple midwives in the group. Maybe we'll ask about it in one of our sessions because whenever questions like this come up, I'm always like, okay, we've got some midwives.
Yeah. We'll ask them like, why does back pain even, like, how do you know just by looking at her face or the way she's breathing? Just experience, you know, you just see enough women in a day and you know what's happening by the look on their face. It's fascinating.
But if you ever, I mean, I've had a couple of friends who had that experience and if you talk to them, it's just not the same. Like, I think you can manage the pain a bit better when it's like a, you know, when the baby's that in the position that it's supposed to be. I think it's obviously still labor. It doesn't tickle, but like you can, I think, manage it. And I think it's a little different. Like when I've spoken to women who've had the back labor, it's like, just, it seems harder to manage.
It made me throw up. So I'm thinking like it just may, yeah, like the nausea that it causes is wild.
Wow. All right. Well, I know that.
Fun to process. Thank you.
Yeah. No, I'm really glad that you shared your story. I feel like also, I don't know. I just feel like I feel like sharing it in this way, hopefully it's part of like your journey and allowing you to kind of get it out. Cause like, I feel like, I don't know. I feel like, well, of course, whenever I share episodes that are kind of real life stories, I think it's always important for the listeners because there's so many women that are going to be able to relate in one way or another to your story, but also to give you an opportunity to actually just like get it out a little bit.
Get it out. It's very helpful. And I'm sure a lot of your listeners are looking to get pregnant. I'm sure like a huge percentage of them are interested in this for that purpose. And it's just good for you to know, like, yeah. Self-isolate for the last month, please, just in case. and goodness. Just yeah, like that tip of know that you'll have all the information that you want, or you might know what you want and how you want to handle certain things during or after childbirth, but you become a different person. And you can't necessarily rely on the conscious person who's doing the research today to be there and show up in the moment. And in today's world, you might need to prepare to be by yourself. Like, I'm sure no one considers that they might need to be by themselves, as it, like, that's not something that comes up. And I don't know, maybe by the time you hear this, that'd be less likely. I don't know. But I didn't think that would be a thing for me. And it's a thing for a lot of people at the moment. So
just jumping into today's episode with some exciting news to share. The Fertility Awareness Mastery Mentorship Program, Class of 2022, starts in January. If you've been searching for a practical way to incorporate fertility awareness cycle charting into your existing women's health practice, then this is the program you've been waiting for. The Fertility Awareness Mastery Mentorship is a 9-month training program that provides the necessary training to incorporate fertility awareness cycle charting into your existing practice. This program cuts out all of the fluff by combining the science with the practical application of charting and allows you to support your clients by monitoring their fifth vital sign in a standardized way. Transform your practice in 9 months. Apply now at fertilityfriday.com/FAMMLive. That's FAMMLIVE. fertilityfriday.com/FAMMLive. Now let's go ahead and jump back into today's episode. That's such a powerful, because you're right. I mean, I don't even, you know, even knowing that this is happening, I don't really think of that either. I remember a long time ago, because like I said, one of my good friends is a labor and delivery nurse. And so she's, you know, been present for probably at this point, thousands of births, you know, because then when you're in the hospital, you just volume
you a day
when that's what you do. And one of the things that she said, now I'm not saying this is correct or incorrect, but I remember when we were in our kind of early 20s and we were talking about this, we used to have these conversations because she was a labor delivery nurse and she was very hospital medicalized. Like, I'm going to have my birth in a hospital. And I was always very much like, and I want to just like be in my house and have a midwife. And so we'd always have these interesting conversations. But one of the things that she said, and that I feel like I learned from her, was that she said that sometimes when she had patients that were very type A, like, and I need to have the blue blanket on the left side kind of thing. Like, when they were super, super type A, often things did not go how they wanted to. And it was much more difficult for that particular personality type because they needed it to be just so.
Oh yeah.
And so I feel like what came out of those conversations with her, cause I was very much like on the other end of like flowers and unicorns in my basement, right? Like birthing tubs and whatever.
I like the thinking that there's a unicorn over in the corner, just standing there while you're like in the tub.
Well, something relaxing, right? Like there was like, I picture dim lighting and like the whole thing, right? But one of the things that came out of that conversation was like, at the end of the day, like what you said, you want to leave the hospital with your healthy child, and how they come into the world isn't always, sometimes what matters is that, you know, you have a healthy child at the end of it. And so I suppose what I took from that was, yeah, make your plan. I don't think there's anything wrong with making a plan and outlining what would be your ideal birth scenario. But especially what you said, Dani, with this time, like there has to be a category of like, what if? But I feel like at the end of the day, there has to be like an openness to how it unfolds. And I also feel that it's like a metaphor of motherhood, because you, when you have a child, like it's a child, it's their own individual human that has their own personality and their own opinions and their own, you know what I mean? And so you might have all these ideas of how everything's going to be, but you end up with this little person who has their own ideas. So oh, I feel yeah. like it's like a, it's a very, even like a, it's almost like it's like a metaphor or like a introduction to motherhood. Sometimes the birth not going as you want it, because it's literally like welcome to motherhood, where things don't go where you thought, they don't go how you thought they were going to go. Things don't go according to plan. Children have their own personalities and desires. That, like, and so
on that like woo-woo train, which, you know, I'm not wildly like that, but there's a part of me that thinks that I got was so overdue, right? Like we had some meconium, we had two, she was like ready to go. Part of me thinks that my body or her, I don't know, someone knew that now was not a good time. And that's why I made it a whole extra week, almost, because my, like, it, is my body smart enough? Probably. Like, it wouldn't shock me for it to be like, we'll go into labor when you reach a certain, like, 10% more lung capacity or something like that, just enough to get me able to do it. And I kind of feel like that's what happened. And yeah, I just trust your body, but not the plan.
Yeah. Oh, yes. That's amazing. Oh, yeah. Thank you. You're welcome. I feel like now I don't think I've ever done a full birth story. No, I think I've done maybe a couple, maybe over the years, maybe like one or two birth stories on the show.
Well, but no, everyone listening to this show, once they get pregnant, that's where they'll go. Trust me. They'll start listening to the Birth Hour and all those other podcasts. So this is a transitional episode for those people.
Yes, definitely. All right. Well, let's switch gears a little bit. I did want to ask you, we had talked about a couple of things actually before we hit record. And one of them was just getting back to your professional kind of just your story of what brought you into the work. I think we touched on that because you obviously struggled with HA yourself. And one of the questions I wanted to ask you, because we've talked about this before, was with your niche. So, you know, there's a lot of general kind of health coaches, quote unquote, who just looks like, I love women's health, and it's very general. Mm-hmm. But there's nothing wrong with that. But in your case, you obviously have this very specific focus on women with HA. And I just love to hear a little bit about that, because I think it's like completely opposite topic going from birth to like business. But I think for a lot of professionals who may be listening, it can be scary to think like, if I only work with women with HA, like, will I even have a practice? Like, you know what I mean? Like it's often scary to think about reducing your offering to a specific group of people.
Yeah. I mean, it is, but it's so much easier, and more people are becoming aware that like niching makes perfect sense. There really isn't a whole lot of women. I just love women's health who actually know how and where to start with women with HA. Many of them do, but they often don't come back to me when you have the hormones for us to look at. And I don't run labs or anything with anyone. I don't need to look at labs to know that you don't have any hormones. That's not helpful information. And actually it's like a total sidebar, but it's a massive pet peeve of mine that people obsess about their labs when they have HA. But I wanted to be able to work with people who I've really understood. Like, I've been there. I know exactly how you're feeling, and I have a ton of compassion and empathy for it. I can't have compassion and empathy for someone who had PCOS or for someone who, like just trying to get pregnant, like just wants to learn charting, something like that. It like really speaks to my heart, right? To talk to people who are going through this. And I wanted to start working with them in this capacity because there's some people, I don't know, who are like coaching women through HA to just eat more and rest, and helping them, I guess, with like the mindset piece and just helping them understand that that's how it works. That's the science, that's the biology of how it works. But I really started to see like the gap in taking them the whole way. Like, these people are helping people get periods back, but then what about the rest of it? Like, what about the cycle optimization? And these people want to get their period back 9 times out of 10 because they want to get pregnant. So like, what do they do now? And I wanted to create that continuity of care for people with HA. And then that opens up the niche, because suddenly you're not just trying to get them their period back, but you're trying to get them their period back and then optimized and then pregnant and then postpartum get their period back. And it's like, that's like a long-term client, and they need that continuity of care, because then they're going from like coach or practitioner to practitioner to practitioner just to get this one result that really it's all related. So the HA is just like my entry point for these people. And then once we have our period back, they kind of become like any other person that you're working with in cycle charting. So like they technically could come and get their period back with me and then happily go and work with you and get the exact same like result. But like, why not just do it all myself?
Well, and I would argue that in some ways, yes, once a person who struggled with HA gets their period back, in some ways, they're like any other client who's working on getting their cycle organized. But I mean, I've worked with a number of women with HA as well, and or a history of HA. So kind of in that example of like, they have done the work to get their period back and now they have their cycles. But often women with HA still struggle with kind of more specific kind of, because they do have this history of whether, whatever it is, exercise. And so I feel like even though, yes, in some ways it's similar, I feel like it's still helpful to be very aware of that history, because it's not hard to kind of fall back into a little bit of that overexercise, kind of under eating. But now it's not to the point that you're losing your period, but it could still be negatively impacting your cycle. That's what I tend to see characteristic of those clients.
Yeah. And they're so often feel like the reason their second period or third or fourth period hasn't come or is like 60 days or something is just because it takes time for your hormones to figure themselves out. And to a degree, that's true, but not to like a 60-day cycle degree. And when we see that happening, I know what's going on. And I know how to ask them or how to find out and how to dig into whether or not they're slipping back into old habits. Because that's ultimately what's actually making the consecutive cycles harder to get. And the consecutive cycles are harder to get because when you get your first period, that's easier because there's this very objective goal that's, I want to bleed. And then you get your bleed, maybe you get two bleeds, and then you're like, well, gosh, that confirms that I've gained weight. Or like, how do I feel about that? Or okay, I have two periods now. Like I really can't justify continuing to rest or continuing to gain weight or continuing to eat because I have a period now. So it's like, it's more there. It feels to them more subjective, more like gray, which type A personalities don't like. So we need to be constantly having conversations around, it's important that you keep going down this route. And I can see just by looking at your chart that like you're struggling here maybe, and a lot of kind of therapeutic conversations about it in order to get like six periods in a row or something.
Well, and as you know, I mean, with the work that I do with clients and as we've gone through in so much detail in our mentorship program together, this is one of the reasons why understanding the menstrual cycle and being able to utilize the menstrual cycle as a vital sign and to really be able to dig into it, that's one of the ways that it can really enhance your client work, because then it moves from this, because even when I think about it, like the concept of like, my goal is to get my period back and then we're done makes no sense. Because if you want to have a baby, there's like a lot of things that should be addressed post HA, because if you are undernourishing your body for a long period of time and overexercising, arguably, you're not even getting enough macronutrients to support hormone production. So how could you, you know, potentially be getting enough micronutrients to optimize your body for pregnancy? So maybe share with us, you know, why you chose to jump into the FAMM program when you did and how the kind of rabbit hole of charting menstrual cycle, understanding the menstrual cycle as a vital sign in much more depth has already helped you with your clients, or how you anticipate it'll help you in your client work?
Yeah. So I had started working with women basically in that kind of like initial capacity I explained, or just like helping them get comfortable with eating more and blah, blah, blah. And then realizing like, I need more information to be able to provide like a service that I really feel good about. And I was just using it for myself, getting interested. And if I had a client who was open to it, I would be like, do you want to try this and see? I was already experimenting with it. And then you just had announced, like, I mean, how it doesn't happen very often when someone is selling like exactly the thing that you need. Like, I'm not a course buyer. I don't do that, but it was exactly the thing I needed to like differentiate myself in the market, honestly. And, to like allow myself to learn more, like this, like exactly how do I use this as a diagnostic tool? How do I use the chart to see what is going wrong or going right with someone? And then how do I troubleshoot it? Like, that's a big one. Okay, I could learn how to spot things that are outside of the normal parameters or the optimal parameters, but what do I do? Like, how do I help them? And that I knew I had a very, like a lot I could learn. And that would help clients immensely. So since then, even though I'm not finished yet, I've obviously been able to apply this stuff as I've gone. So I took your entire intake process, your client intake process, and I use it. Like I fill this form out and then use the process for how to assess it. And that has been hugely helpful. I wasn't doing that before. I was just like, let's get on a call and like listening to them tell me in real time their story, which is valuable. But now I've gone through all of that before we even meet. And it makes our calls so, I already have recommendations. I'm so much more confident personally, like going into that first call. It's not nerve-wracking at all. Like, you feel like you know so much about this person. So that has been really, really huge for me, just to be providing a really good service and feeling confident in my own ability to like read through what they're telling me. Because when they just tell you what's wrong or like what's happening, they're missing information, right? They forget things or they don't know that certain things are important. And then just being able to look at their charts, because once they get their period back too, I continue with them until they have had a few or fix whatever scenarios we're seeing need fixing or get pregnant, which is so much fun, so much fun. And I can help them figure it out and like time for conception. And that's just so rewarding. So basically being able to provide a complete package from intake to using it as a diagnostic tool to helping them understand like what is actually happening and how they can then also chart themselves after we work together, and helping them either like avoid having to use birth control or to help them get pregnant. Like, I've gained a ton of information and resources in every single one of those areas. So it just was directly applicable to what I was looking for.
Oh, that's awesome. It's, it's exciting to see how you can apply it into your practice, because I know that, the intake process that you talked about, it can be quite extensive. And I think one of the potential challenges that I see for practitioners who want to incorporate fertility awareness into their practice is that I often think that people really underestimate what it is, because it's fairly straightforward if you think about it, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, there's cervical fluid and there's basal body temperature and there's cervical position. And like, how hard could this be? Right? Like, I feel like there's a certain kind of underestimate what is really involved. So if someone for the listener who, you know, has their own professional practice is kind of like, hey, you know, I think this might be something that would be useful for my practice, what would you want them to know about the process? Did it surprise you? Did you find that, this is all super easy? Or did anything about it surprise you in terms of like the depth that we went in or anything like that?
Honestly, like, I knew going into it where I bet you we're going to meet every week and then there's going to be assessments. That was probably like on the FAQ or something. Like, I kind of went in knowing that that would happen, which made me anxious, but I was pleasantly surprised to know that like it's open book, like you can go and figure out the answer. And that was really helpful for my learning, which I didn't think I expected. Like, I probably thought I was going to have to survive a lot of the learning curves, but really like you can kind of take your time and reread it. And that actually helps you retain the information. And so I was pleasantly surprised to enjoy homework, if that makes sense. And yeah, just it like met expectations, which like doesn't sound good. Like, in terms of workload, you know, didn't feel overwhelming. I was able to get it to get each week's done in about 2 hours, like attending the call, doing the homework. But I had no idea, honestly, like no expectations on whether I would walk away feeling more confident or not. And I'm really excited and happy about how much confidence and more knowledge that I have. So I definitely doubted my ability to like feel, I don't know, like smart enough, but it was all really digestible. And like, you did a really good job of making all the handouts and spacing out the information as much as is possible with something that honestly is like a lot of information. And, you know, there's just like a lot of availability. And I think it's really helpful to be able to like talk to you in the Slack and have the Q&A sessions and just to fill in all of the gaps. So yeah, it was, yeah, definitely everything that I needed without being too much work because we're all busy. So oh, yeah. I appreciate that I can do it and get a lot out of it in like essentially 2.5 to 3 hours a week, if that.
Yeah. Well, you know, thank you for your kind words. I mean, I'm certainly glad to hear that you, yeah, you just said so many nice things. So I'm really glad to hear that. It's fun. I had a blast with this group. I thought it was everyone in the group was so kind. And I feel also that because everyone in the group has their own area of specialization, each person brought a lot of knowledge to the group. I feel like in our calls, there was a lot of
cool.
Yeah. I thought that was really
practitioners.
Cool.
Yeah. I tell you, I ran into Justine at the chiropractor a few weeks ago.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Was that the first time you had met?
Yeah, it was like, but she recognized my voice while I was in my appointment. And I walked out, ah! It was like really weird to see someone in person. Like your brain knows what's happening. Your brain doesn't really know what's happening. But yeah, we'll have to meet up for a coffee or something in Austin.
Oh, that's fun. Yeah, that's one thing. It would be so nice to at least have like one opportunity or more to be able to meet up with everybody. This might sound like a silly thing, but whenever I meet people that I've only really known online, this has happened like a couple of times. I ran into one of my clients once and I didn't recognize her at first because one of the things that trips me out is the height difference.
Yeah.
The height. So I'm pretty, I don't know if I'm average, maybe a little more than average. I'm like 5'7", but that's one thing that is hilarious when you meet people in person. Some people are really small and you wouldn't know. And some people are really tall. Anyways, for me, that's always like.
No, totally. And like, this is a weird one, but people's skin, I think plays a role in like your, how you, I don't know, your brain just processes them. But when you only know someone on Zoom, you actually have no idea like the fine details of someone's face. That's and true. You meet them in real life and it's kind of freaky how high definition they are in real life.
Well, it's true. And if they have like little like laugh lines, yes, I could see that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So maybe someday I would love to have a FAMM meetup in person, but we'll have to see what happens in our highly variable world. Yes. Well, Dani, I mean, I could talk to you forever. I feel like I could still ask you a bunch more questions, but I suppose at some point we have to get back to our busy days. So I just want to thank you for sharing your story. I feel like we covered a lot of ground. We kind of meandered and your birth story. Again, I'm really thankful that you were able to share that. And also just to kind of share a little bit about your experience in the FAMM program for anyone who's kind of like thinking about doing it. So I suppose the one last question would be for that person who's listening and they kind of tuned in because they wanted to kind of find out the skinny on the program. If someone was thinking about joining, what would you want them to know?
Oh, yeah. If you're wondering if it's for you or not, if you work with women on hormones, yes, it's for you. Because regardless, like you could not ever do charting with them, but you're still going to get a lot of information out of it. But I guarantee you that if you don't know if you want to do charting with them, you'll realize that it's a huge tool that you're missing out on, right? So I think it makes sense that, like, wouldn't it be cool if every women's health practitioner like ensured that their client was charting? And you need to know how that works if you're going to do that. So yes, if you work with women on their health, it would make a lot of sense that you did that you did the course.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I mean, of course, I feel like I'm a little biased because this is what I've been doing for so long, but I can't imagine. I mean, I don't have to because all of my clients chart, but like, I can't imagine working with somebody without the chart part of it. I would just want to know, like, how would I, like, after your experience in the class, like, it would drive me nuts if I can't see what's happening with your luteal phase. I can't gauge your progesterone. Like, I always,
Well, I get a lot of questions from people who aren't my clients who will just be like, oh my God, there's just like one piece of random information that like, I just know, like I need to see your chart now. Like this is not, it's physically impossible for me to answer that question without your chart. So I honestly find myself saying to most people, like, I would need a lot more information from you. Is the answer to every question.
Well, see, I feel like now I've given you like, cause this is how I feel all the time. Right. And so for example, I get a lot of, unfortunately I'm not as responsive on social media. There's so many questions and it might seem like a small question, you know, like I've been trying to get pregnant for 3 months and I saw this weird thing with my mucus. Can you tell me what's wrong? That might seem like a small question, but in order for me to give you an appropriate answer, it's like, I need to do a full intake. I need to find out what's going on with your partner. I've got to like, see like your most recent charts and like, right.
Yeah. So it's crazy. Yeah. But it's true. Exactly. Yeah. You can help women so much more with that information. And if you're like, if you're trying to help women, like if you try to answer that question
without all the information, so I feel like this was my goal, actually. It's interesting with the program, which is to kind of welcome you into like, let's look at this in a professional way and see how actually telling that woman, well, just take this drug that's going to make your mucus better, could be a complete disservice to her because you really don't even know what's going on. And that might not even be the problem at all.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. 100%. And I love seeing all of the medications that they've been on before for something that's like, well, honestly, like there's a million things we can do without you needing to go on to medication. Or in my field, obviously what I hear all the time is like, but they want to start me on IVF soon, or I'm being told I probably won't be able to have kids or I have ovarian failure, just like serious stuff that it's like actually not that big a deal. Like it's actually more simple, but without all of this information, we can't figure that out.
Yeah. It's hard to explain. I feel like you put it into words because it's like complicated in a way, but then, well, if you think about the human body, the way I think about the human body is such that if you are a woman, a biological female of reproductive age, mm-hmm. ovulation is a part of the deal, kind of like breathing is a part of the deal or like blinking and stuff. So like, if you just didn't blink anymore, that would be a problem. And that's kind of a silly example, but I feel like my point is coming across. We have to think about reproductive function as being a part of a healthy adult female body. And so from that perspective, then it can be very complicated, but it's also very simple often. Like for women with HA, I always say like, it's often very simple for them to get their periods back. It doesn't mean that's easy though. It's like not easy at all, but it's like relatively simple. Like there's a recipe that we can follow to get the period back, but that's just not always, it's not like it's so straightforward because there's a lot of different factors that go into why she isn't eating.
Yes. there's a lot going on, but it's all manageable.
Exactly.
We can get there without you having to take any kind of pill form most of the time.
But we're happy that the medication is there in case we ever need it. So,
totally. Because another part of it's like sometimes women are on some kind of clock. They're mid-30s, or their husband is on deployment, or all of the above. And it's like, okay, look, I would love to be able to do this and do it the natural way and yada yada, but like time's a ticking, and we'll still work together because IVF, like they've tried it and it didn't stick. It's like, okay, well, let's just get your body to a place where maybe it works, like where it takes. And that's sometimes just the goal. And that's okay. We're a mixture of both, like a hybrid model.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, so Dani, let us know. So tell us a little bit about where people can go to find information about you, what you do, your podcast, website, coaching programs, all the places.
Thanks. So I'm the Hypothalamic Amenorrhea Podcast. You type that in, that will come up. And the hasociety.com, that's where I support all of the women with that. And we have like a community group. So you don't have to do one-on-one coaching, but you can do like group coaching, and we meet every week. Or you can work with me one-on-one or one of my other team members, which is pretty cool. And it's all at thehasociety.com.
Awesome. Well, we will make sure to link all of the places. Thank you again for being here. This was super fun, and congratulations again. We're very excited for you. And now that you're healed and everything, we hope you have a wonderful first year with your new baby.
Thank you. Yeah. So far, so good.
Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed today's show, please share it with a friend. You'll find the show notes page for today's episode over at fertilityfriday.com/396. I hope that you enjoyed today's episode. I just want to say a special shout out to Dani. Thank you for sharing your birth story with us. I know the other members of the program, I don't think we actually went through and talked about this in the class. So for all the members of the program, I'm sure they'll also be very interested to hear your experience on the podcast. It's terrifying to think about going through the process of birth without as many support people as you want, to be limited in that, and to potentially have to do it without your partner, even for a period of time. That is such a terrifying reality for many women who are giving birth during this difficult time. So I'm sure that there are many listeners who really appreciated hearing this story. And even for some of you who've maybe had a similar experience, if you've also given birth during this time, just to hear that you're not alone, I'm sure that is very, very meaningful and very helpful. And we also appreciated you sharing your experience from the practitioner aspect of how incorporating the underlying, what I call foundational factors, into your practice using the techniques that you learn in FAMM. We really appreciated hearing how that is changing the way that you are working with clients. So for those of you who are thinking about joining the 2022 class of FAMM, we're just about wrapping up enrollment here. So we start the very first week of January. So if you're listening to this episode in real time, we're almost at the kind of last call mark. So head over to fertilityfriday.com/FAMMLive. That's FAMMLIVE for details about registration and how to apply. Registration will be open either until the program is full or until we get to that last day deadline. So with that said, I hope you have a wonderful weekend whenever you're tuning into the show. I hope that you have a wonderful holiday season. If you're celebrating Christmas or any other variety of holiday during this time, I hope that you have a wonderful holiday season with your loved ones, with your family. And of course, as always, until next time, be well and happy charting.